Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him, and assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, 'And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word, that I too may go and worship him." After listening to the king, they went on their way. And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them, until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced greatly with exceedingly great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and they worshiped him. Then, opening their treasure, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way. For many of us, we find in our lives that we may be seeking God this morning. We realize, for most of us, that in our hearts, we know we need God. So maybe all the family drama that you just went through from Thanksgiving and Christmas has ignited that fire in you to realize, man, I got to get my life straightened out. My family's a mess. My family line's a mess. My family generations are a mess. I need to come and connect with God. And so for many of us, we are seeking God this morning, right now as we sit here. We're seeking God's will for ourselves. Many of us, we come here because our wife nagged us or because we drank too much last night and we're like, "Dude, I need to get straight. I need to come back to church." We may be here for other reasons that are not seeking God. But I want to make this clear to you. God has built you and your heart for himself. And you will be restless in your own heart, whether you're here or not, to even find God. You will be restless. I'm just letting you know. You'll be restless in your heart till you come to peace with God. Until you seek him and find him, you will wander. But the beautiful part of knowing God is that when you seek him, he says, "You will find me." But watch this. Sometimes we seek, but we don't want to find. We'd rather just stay in the journey saying, "Oh, I haven't really found what I'm looking for. And I still haven't found what I'm looking for." Any U2 fans? No? Nobody? Okay. Everybody here's too young? Okay. See here, watch the hypocrisy of being human. Ready? We say we're seeking something, but in reality, we don't really want to find it. Because in the seeking, we can always have an excuse not to change because we haven't found it yet. So we stay in this oblivion of seeking so we don't have to change. Oh, it's what we call in our society, "I'm an agnostic." No, that just means you're weak mentally. Because what is out there to be found can be found. But what we say is, I'm seeking. Which is okay to seek, but understand this. God is not far from you. He's right here. So don't think in your mind, "I'm just seeking." Okay. But understand this. If you truly seek, you will find. Don't say to yourself, "I just haven't figured it out yet." Because God will help you figure it out, but you just have to have a heart that wants to find the answer. But the problem is we really don't want to find the answer because we know if we find the answer, that answer is going to have us change. And we don't want to change. So we just hide back in seek land. We hide back in our seek mode. And God goes, nope, you seek me, you'll find me. I'm not far. You might be far, but I'm not far. I will draw near to you if you desire to draw near to me. And this morning, we are going to see three, theoretically, men who sought after Jesus and found him. It's the story of the three wise men. But I'm going to wreck your Christmas. Ready? Ready? I'm going to destroy your childhood. Ready? You didn't know you were going to get your childhood destroyed this morning, but I will do it. Many of us, we're setting up our nativity scene. If you have any, how many of you guys have a nativity scene? Carved out of wood or, you know, a camel's hoof or whatever. You bought it at Costco, you know, right? Okay. We set up our nativity scenes, you know, above the fireplace or whatever you got on the table, however you do it in your family. Now, if you were to open up your nativity scene and dump out all the pieces, and there wasn't three wise men in there, you go, oh man, they ripped me off. Where's the three wise men? Can't believe it. Places are getting cheaper and cheaper. Now they don't even throw in the three wise men. Or you buy the lawn ornament, the big plastic guys, you know, with the, you put the bulb in the bottom to light them up or whatever. Typically, you got Jesus, you know, the German white-haired, you know, Jesus or whatever, blue-eyed Jesus, laying in the plastic little bin thing, and you have Mary and you got Mary in her little blue thing or whatever, you know, her little thing, and she's like, you know, going like this, and Joseph's like, you know, he's hardly even in the scene, he's just like over here hanging out, going like this. But you got the three wise men, right? And they're like in some form of going like this or whatever, and they're all stacked up, one, two, three. The funny part of that story, ready? I'm sorry. I'm going to tell you I'm sorry up front. The three wise men are not even in the nativity story. I know. God isn't real. Yes, he is very real. The problem is that people have conflated, packed together all the stories of Jesus' birth. The three wise men, watch, I'm going to blow your minds, ready? They weren't even at the manger. They didn't come to the manger. So, you could go home, those of you that are really OCD, you're going to take all your wise men out of the thing and throw them away or whatever. Or here, even better, watch this. About August of next year, 2016, take your nativity scene out, pull the three wise men out, take Jesus and set him on there, and just the three wise men with Jesus. Because that's this story in Matthew 2. Jesus is almost a year old. Jesus has actually moved into a house. He's not in the stable or cave where he was born. He was born in a stable or a cave. That's cave and stable together, the cable. He was born in a stable because it was an emergency situation. After he was born there, though, he moved in with relatives. Mary, Joseph, and Jesus moved in with their relatives, which lived in Bethlehem, which is why it says that they came to a house. When they saw where the star went over the house, they went into the house. Mary and Joseph are now living in a house. So you've got Mary with infant baby Jesus, about a year old, and you've got Joseph living with relatives, much like some of you who came to visit relatives or went to visit relatives at Christmas, right? Whether you wanted them to be in your house or not, they came to visit you. So it's kind of the same with Mary and Joseph. They're staying with relatives here in Bethlehem at the house. So that's where we start our story. Number one, the wise men do their best studying. The wise men do their best studying. After Jesus was born, Mary and Joseph moved into a house in Bethlehem around 4 BC when Jesus was around a year old. So I'm not going to go into the whole story about why Jesus is born before he was born, okay? Jesus is born around 4 or 5 BC, which is before Christ, all right? The reason our time frames are screwed up is because the monk that actually put our calendar together missed a whole bunch of dates. And so he was off by about 4 to 5 years. So Jesus was actually born about 4 or 5 years before he was born, okay? That's why when you say, Jesus was born 4 years before Christ, that doesn't even make any sense. Right, it doesn't make sense because he screwed up on the calendar in the Middle Ages, all right? So Jesus is born about, by our reckoning, by about 4 BC, about 4 to 5 BC. Around 4 BC, when Jesus was around a year old, men who specialized in studying wisdom literature, astronomy, interpretation of dreams, and magic arts called magi, and the Greek word there is magoi, which means magician, but it's not the magician you would hire to be at your children's party. So it's not the magician that goes, hey, look at this pot, ah, there's a rabbit. Or, oh, I pulled a coin out of my ear. It's not that guy. It's not the magician the way we think of magician. It was actually a magician from the standpoint of 2,000 years ago. They were the most elite intellects of their day. The magi were the PhDs of their day. They were the studiers of literature. They were the studiers of culture. They were the studiers of astronomy. They were the most learned, elite, wealthy men of their day outside of the royal family. And so the Magi now are in Babylon. They are among some of the best libraries of the ancient world. They have in their library the Jewish Old Testament. And they have mastered, they're Gentiles. They've mastered the Jewish Old Testament, which happens to have the book of Daniel inside of it, which we're going to look at the reason why that's important. The Magi traveled from the east. The Magi didn't come from the Eastern Orient. So when we see in the Bible that they came from the east, it doesn't mean like China. They did not come from the Far East. They actually came from somewhat of the Near East. So if you look at this map, they came from Babylon, which is east of the Euphrates River. So that's the east they're coming from. They didn't come from way over in China, way over to the far right. So they came from the east in comparison to where Israel is today. Many Jews were taken to Babylon when they conquered Judah in 605 BC, including Daniel, who was considered a wise man of Babylon. So you're in Matthew. Keep your finger in Matthew 2, but I want you to turn back in your Bible to Daniel. It's right after Ezekiel. It's only a few books back, actually, in the Old Testament from Matthew. I want you to turn to Daniel 5. Daniel 5:11. This is fantastic, because this is hundreds of years before Jesus. And what had happened was God gave a rebellious Israel into the hands of the Babylonians. The Babylonians, you see from that map, they came all the way around conquering all these nations. They came all the way around down to the Mediterranean Sea, and they conquered Judah, which is Israel, modern-day Israel. They watch what they did. They grabbed all the elite, especially the young men, all the young, promising men, all the wealthy families, the politicians, everybody that could rule there, and they hauled them all off and took them back to Babylon. Daniel was one of those that got captured. The book of Daniel in your Bible, he got captured in 605 BC. He ends up in Babylon and becomes one of the wise men of Babylon. Look what it says right here. Daniel 5:11. This is one of the men of Babylon giving a testimony about Daniel in 11 to the king. There is a man in your kingdom in whom is the spirit of the holy gods. In the days of your father, light and understanding and wisdom, like the wisdom of the gods, were found in him. And King Nebuchadnezzar, your father the king, made him chief of the magicians, enchanters, Chaldeans, and astrologers, because an excellent spirit, knowledge, and understanding to interpret dreams, explain difficult riddles, and solve problems was found in this Daniel, whom the king called Belteshazzar. Now let Daniel be called, and he will show you the interpretation. So the reason I say that is because Daniel, as a follower of God, was in a foreign country, and he was found to be not only of excellent mind, but excellent spirit. And let me make this point to you, if you're a studier of books. Do I got any readers out here? People just like to read? Remember books when they used to be made back in the day? Okay. It doesn't do any good to get more knowledge without a heart for God. You can be genius, but have missed God. Because God is not of mind only, but it's of motivation and heart. If you fill your mind up with knowledge, but you lack God, you actually lack understanding. Because watch, God is the builder of all things. It doesn't do good to study one little aspect of everything God has built and miss the God that built it. It doesn't do any good to study without having the Spirit of God in you. Because you miss the God that built everything that you're studying. I remember when I was getting my master's degree, I remember going through this tome, this monster book. It was like thousands of pages. If you've ever gotten your master's degree or your PhD, you have to focus on a very specific aspect, and the very specific aspect of whatever you're doing, math or philosophy or science of whatever sort, you study guys that have taken a certain aspect of your discipline and have just beat it out into just minutia. Like, just like, you don't even care about the big stuff, but they made it into like little stuff that you could even care less about. So I remember going through in my master's degree, I'm going, I remember sitting in front of my computer as I was about ready to do this essay on this particular aspect of theology. And I'm reading this book and I'm going, I mean, I love God. I love theology, and I hate this particular book. I'm sitting there at my computer. You know how you just like freeze up sometimes? You're like, Jesus in heaven, help. I can't even press A. I was really praying to God. I go, God, you know what? I couldn't care less about this particular thing. Do I even have to get my master's degree? I mean, who cares, right? You know, God really spoke to me. As I'm staring at my screen, I had nothing on it on a Word document. And he spoke to me, he goes, it's one of two things, Jim. It's either that you don't want to or that you can't. Is it that you can't? And I said, no, I can't. Oh, so then it's that you don't want to learn. Dang it, Jesus, stop! I just remember going, it's the discipline of learning that challenges your mind. But watch, if you just do it for your mind's sake, your heart becomes empty. Because you can be a genius and leave God. And God goes, what are you doing? You learned a whole bunch of stuff that now has no value to you because it didn't draw you closer to me. If you're in science, your mind should be blown away by how God has built the universe. If you're in philosophy, you should be blown away about the fact about how things are logical. If you raise kids, you should be blown away about how God has built the body. Whatever you do, knowledge should never preclude God. Knowledge should actually bring you closer to God. It should drive you to more amazement for God. And these magi were that exact way. They had all the learning of the ancient world, yet it didn't drive them to be atheists. It actually drove them to the true God. It drove them to Jesus. Intellect, divorced from your heart, is valueless. But passion, connected to your heart with intellect, is how to live your life. Because God is both. You know the reason ants don't build a skyscraper? You know the reason an aardvark doesn't build a hospital so you can get help? It just goes around with that little weird little nose thing, whatever that thing is. You want to know why? You want to know why the animal world doesn't care about you? It's because you have been given an intellect from God. God didn't give everything else. God could have made you a termite. He didn't. God could have made you a giraffe. He didn't. God could have made you a baboon. He didn't. You're not a highly evolved ape. You are a special creation of God. Apes are apes and you are human. That's the reason we can tell the difference. It's not because it's at the end of the evolutionary tree. God built you special. God put an intellect inside of you. He didn't build into anything else. One of the main images of God inside of you, my friend, is not just your moral nature, but it's the fact that you have intellect to understand. God has put a mind inside of you he didn't put inside of anything else. So here's my point. You got to use your brain for Jesus. Stop being lazy and pick your brain up and go to work. Stop just thinking about Twitter followers and start following Jesus. Oftentimes when we get older, we get lazy. What's on the internet today? But God's word waits for you. You can hear some of the best teaching in the world at your fingertips. There's everything to pour into your mind. And the Magi did that. They didn't get lazy. They used what God gave them to the best of their ability. Intellect, curiosity, and learning is a reflection of God's image and glory in your life. The wise men did their best studying. Hey, if you're in school, you've probably got classes you absolutely hate. You're like, Jesus, I will never use trigonometry in my whole life. I will never use these proofs in geometry for the rest of my life. In the history of humanity, no one's ever used this. But guess what? You know what it does? It challenges you to learn how to learn. It forces your brain to be uncomfortable. And when we're uncomfortable, we learn. That's the value of learning. And the Magi did that. They were studying other cultures' history so they could learn about a culture that they haven't even been to. And actually, this would lead them to Jesus. The wise men did their best studying. Number two, the wise men do their best searching. The wise men do their best searching. Even as Gentiles, the Magi had access to the book of Daniel and the prophecy of Balaam that a star would come out of Jacob. So in Numbers 24:17, God gives this really kind of false prophet the prophecy that a star is going to rise out of Jacob. It's going to come out of Israel. There's going to be somebody that will rise like in priority out of Jacob, out of Israel. And so they take that. They know this obscure prophecy from another culture that this star is going to rise out of Jacob. And God does this amazing thing where he makes this astronomical anomaly appear in the sky. And they from Babylon look into the sky because they have studied the stars, and the stars stay in their constellations. So they move, but they're very consistent. As the stars all interact and they turn, they know exactly how the stars are going to go. But all of a sudden, boom shaka, they see the star. They go, where did that come from? And they unroll their scrolls and they go, I've never seen that one. Right above Orion's belt. And he looks like he's got a spot on his belt. That's weird. It's never been there. And all of a sudden, they realize, because they're learned men that have applied their learning to God, that God is at work. And they start to follow that star. Around 4 BC, the Magi saw an astronomical anomaly and providentially realized it related to the birth of the Messiah of Israel. Being priests and kingmakers, men of this stature didn't travel lightly or alone. Though three gifts were given to Jesus, probably many more than three Magi, along with their entourage, made the trip. So many times when you look at your little nativity scene, there's three guys. Guess what? There probably wasn't just three guys. The Bible doesn't even say there was three guys. You know what it says? It says they gave him three different gifts. And here's the reason I say that. Ready? We think three guys just kind of jumped on some camels. Heading, following the star. Oh, there it goes. And three guys loaded with gold and frankincense, which was expensive, and myrrh, which was even more expensive, just put it in like their JanSport backpack and jumped on a camel and started following a star. Are you crazy? This is the wealthy elite of Babylon. They're traveling around with solid gold in one of the most dangerous areas of the ancient world, which was that highway they took around that went from Babylon to Israel. The wise men, the Magi, probably traveled with a whole entourage. They traveled with guards. They traveled with heavy-duty men around them. So it's like, many of you guys see athletes. So a guy's like from South Central or whatever, and he doesn't have any friends. He just plays basketball his whole life. So you see it on like ESPN. All of a sudden, he's dirt poor just because he didn't do anything else. He just shot basketball his whole life. All of a sudden, God makes him like 6'10", and he can jump out of the gym. He gets signed to a to an NBA contract, he goes from zero to multimillionaire overnight. He goes from no friends to all of a sudden what? He's got 430 friends. It's funny how when you get wealthy, all of a sudden friends just start showing up. Hey, remember me from preschool? No, I don't remember you at all. Yeah, I was that guy that spit in your milk No, I don't remember that. The wealthy and elite traveled heavy. They traveled with an entourage to guard what they were bringing to the king. So while we think that there was just three men, there was probably 50, all traveling to find Jesus, all on the journey to find Christ. Using the main trade route from Babylon, which is about 800 miles, it would take their caravan probably 1.5 to 2 months to travel to Bethlehem. Often the difficult physical journeys of life are designed to help people arrive at the spiritual destinations of God. I can imagine, can you put that map back up? I can imagine as they're traveling, imagine being on the back, not that one, that map, as they're traveling from Babylon, they have to go around this huge mountain range, which is why they took the journey they did. Imagine traveling with all these guys, carrying all this stuff and food to feed everybody for 1.5 months. Think about what you just did for Christmas. How many people did you have in your house? So maybe you had 2, 3, 4 people. All of a sudden, 58 relatives show up, and you got to feed them all. And so everybody's packed around. You got little Johnny sleeping under the table or whatever because you don't even have enough room for everybody. You know, little Greg sleeping on the dog bed or whatever with Fido. You know, you're stuffing people everywhere, and you got to try to feed them. And you're like, dude, I didn't even get paid this month, so let's, you know, take the credit card down to Walmart and let's make sure everybody gets fed. Now imagine taking 50 grown men on a journey of 1.5 months around a mountain range. You can imagine that at some points they were like, dude, do we even know where the star is going? What happens if we go all the way from Babylon to Israel and nobody's there? Anybody thought about that? Has anybody thought about that? It's 1.5 months. They're camping on the ground. Somebody's got to find food. At some point, their physical exhaustion must have just gone, dude, I'm over this journey. Let's just go back to Babylon. I'm wealthy. I'm learned. I have a nice house. Why am I leaving all the luxury to go find who knows who in Israel? And let me make this point. God will put difficulty in your life to put your heart to the test. I can remember when I was 20 years old, man, I would play football all day long. I would do something all day long, and I would wake up the next morning, and my body would be like, yeah, that's awesome. You start rolling through your 30s, your 40s. Your body goes, this ain't awesome. You wake up with chronic hip pain or your knee or your neck. You slip that disc and it's never been fixed. You wake up with headaches every day. You know what's funny about pain is it either drives you inward to be angry or it drives you outward toward God for help. Sometimes God uses medicine. Sometimes God uses a great surgeon. We have great medical stuff in the United States. But understand this. The reason God puts disappointment and pain in your life is that it should drive you to God. It should drive you to desperation. There will be points that God will drive you to desperation on purpose so that you go, dude, what's the point of me being out here? And God will go, I'm the point. I'm the point. And that's exactly what the Magi had to do. They were on their journey. I'm sure they wanted to just give up. Dude, let's just go back to Babylon. That's ridiculous. Why are we even doing this? But guess what? Through the difficulty, you learn lessons about yourself. You learn lessons in difficulty. It's when you're in difficulty that you're challenged to change. If you always stay at equilibrium, you never grow. You never grow in equilibrium. You never grow when it's just room temperature. When it's either too cold, man, when I walked in here this morning, you're lucky you came to the second service. Because the heater didn't work in the first service. And we came in here and it was about 14 below. And I said, hey, guess what? We're going to have church in Russia this morning. So you learn what it's like on the other side of the world for other Christians to go to church. And it you know what? It brought it home to me, actually, at the beginning of the first service, when we couldn't get the heater to work. It works now. But we couldn't get the heater to work at first service. It brought it home to me, like, you know what? It's not about my comfort. This is not about my comfort. It's not that the temperature's right, or that everything's right, or that I don't feel any pain. That's not about it. What's important is that I'm about God. What's important is not whether I feel warm enough. What's important is that God is my main goal in life. And you know what was funny about that moment? Even this morning, God taught me in that first service. Because I'm thinking, dude, it's like a refrigerator in here. It's literally almost like a refrigerator. And God really taught me in that moment, even like an hour and a half ago, that it doesn't matter. Who cares about your comfort? Because God is greater than all. Learning about God is greater than my comfort. Because if I always go for comfort, I never learn. It's like when you go to your master's, you know, like when I talk about I got my master's degree. If I just would have went for comfort, I never would have gotten that. Because I would have gotten lazy. It's like letting the grass grow in your front yard. You're like, dude, I don't want to mow the lawn. And the grass is like 3 feet high. People are like, dude, would you please mow your lawn? No. I'm letting it grow. Because I like grass to grow. I want to see its glory. Hey, its glory is great when it's 2 inches, not when it's 2 feet, brother. The value of my home's going down because you're lazy. So do you need me to mow your lawn? The funny part of living is that it will always be challenging. But God builds challenge in so we grow. Don't ever forget that. The Magi could have given up, but because they stayed with it, they met Jesus. I'm sure many times they wanted to go home, but they stayed the journey to find Christ. Using the main trade route from Babylon, which is about 800 miles, it would take their caravan 1.5 to 2 months to travel to Babylon. Often the physical journeys of life are designed to help people arrive at the spiritual destinations of God. The wise men do their best searching. They give their best to God. And number three, the wise men bring their best to the Savior. The wise men bring their best to the Savior. The wise men do their best studying. The wise men do their best searching. And the wise men bring their best to the Savior. After arriving in Jerusalem, the star stopped shining. So the Magi inquired at King Herod's palace about the Jewish Messiah. As the light could stop, then reappear, and move over a house, it was probably not a true star, but rather the Shekinah glory of God. So actually what we're going to be looking at as we go through Exodus is that God guided the people of Israel through the desert with light from himself. That he doesn't need a source like the sun to give light. He himself can give light wherever he feels like it. Like I believe was the first day of creation, that the sun and the stars weren't even built yet, but there was light because it came from God. And so these Magi look up in the sky and they see this anomaly, this moving star, and they, because they've learned it from scripture, they go after this star. And it says it takes them all the way around that mountain range and all the way down into Israel. And you know where it stops? It doesn't even go to Bethlehem. It like takes a pit stop in Jerusalem. Kind of like when you go on a family journey and you pile all your kids in the van. Many of you did that. Went to like Phoenix or wherever. Maybe you came from Phoenix to here and you put like your 12 kids in the family vanagon or whatever and you got on the 15 or the 5 and you came here. Halfway, kids are like, gosh, I gotta pee. Can you wait? We just got off the freeway like 5 minutes ago. I know, but I drank that 20-gallon Slurpee. We're never going to get there if you guys keep wanting to stop. I told you not to drink that Slurpee, and now we got to stop. All the way along this journey, it could take you 2 hours, but instead, with your 28 kids, it takes you 2 days to get there. This star doesn't take them to Bethlehem. You know where the star takes them? It takes them to Jerusalem. And then it stops shining. Gone. And the Magi, rolling deep with their posse roll into Jerusalem, and you know where they go? Watch this, watch this. You know where they go? They go to King Herod. You want to know one of the craziest verses of the whole Christmas story? And this isn't even Christmas because it's almost a year later, but look at this. Matthew 2, verse 2. Matthew 2, 2, look at it. So the Magi roll into Jerusalem. They go to the palace, and what do they say? To the king, they say this. Where is he who has been born what? King of the Jews. You know why that's crazy? Because you're talking to Herod the Great. You want to know why? What's crazy about talking to Herod the Great? Is that Herod was the Nero slash Hitler of his day. He killed his wives. He killed his sons. He killed everybody that threatened his rule. So when the Magi roll up and they go, hey, where's the king? I mean, Herod must have been like, yeah, where is the king? And you want to know why? I know for almost a fact there wasn't just three wise men. It's because if three guys would have just rolled up into the palace going, so, where's the king? You know what Herod would have done? You know what? Why don't you guys come in the back room here real quick? Shink, shunk, shunk. And your three wise men, the plastic guys in the nativity scene, would have had it, no heads, and they wouldn't even have made it to Jesus. You want to know why their lives survived? Because I believe they rolled with armor. Three guys don't walk up to Herod and go, I know you're the king, but where's the real king? He killed his own sons when he thought that they were going to take over his rule. And you know what Herod does? He goes, yeah, you go find the king. Because I often wondered, why doesn't Herod just go with him? If Herod would have went with him, it would have looked like Herod was looking for the king as well. He would have actually been giving credibility to their search for the king, so he doesn't go with him. He just says, go find him, and then come tell me that I may worship him as well. I'll worship him with my sword, is what's going to happen. Watch how amazing this is. The star could have taken them to Bethlehem. It doesn't. It takes them to Jerusalem so that the Magi can really rebuke Herod, who was only a few miles from Bethlehem, living in Jerusalem the majority of his adult life. He could have gone himself. They had scripture. It showed right in scripture where the Messiah was to be born. They read it themselves, but they were so spiritually lethargic that they didn't go search after Jesus. The Magi had to come from Babylon, from 800 miles away, to go to Jerusalem and then just jump over to Bethlehem when the guys in Jerusalem didn't even go to Bethlehem. And that brings up a really important point. Listen, don't get spiritually lethargic. Don't get spiritually fat. It's one thing to hear, it's another thing to practice. You know, like, everybody remember Jane Fonda from the 80s? Remember? Anybody? Old people? Okay? You remember Jane Fonda? They got the new ones, Jillian, whatever, Richards or whatever her name is. She jumps around, does whatever. So they got all kinds of athletic stuff now that you can work out at home. Anybody get any workout stuff for Christmas? You're like, no, because I tried that last year or whatever, right? It's one thing to have athletic equipment and workout equipment at home or buy a new workout tights or whatever or have a workout video. It's one thing to stare at those things and go, gosh, I wish I could lose some pounds. It's another thing to actually put them on, put the DVD in, and start working out with Jane or whatever. To know is not the same as to do. To know something theologically is not the same as loving God. They had theology, but they didn't have Jesus. The people in Jerusalem. Herod knew about Jesus from the scriptures, but he didn't go find him. He had a chance to know God, and he chose not to. The Magi came from 800 miles away, and they found Jesus. You want to know why? Because the hungry find the food. The spiritually fat, you don't even go. I mean, after Thanksgiving dinner, the last thing you want is more turkey. Right? You're sitting around going, somebody change the channel. I'm too tired to press the button. Will you press this button? Change the channel. The last thing you want to do after Thanksgiving dinner is sit up at the table and eat more. But guess what? Somebody, if you've ever been really hungry, like starving, like I've been eating top ramen one time a day, hungry, you'll find food. You'll desire food. And that's how you have to be spiritually. Do you seek after God? Is God your great desire in life? Because he's the only thing, he's the only one that can fill the void in your heart. He will be your pursuit that will pay off. Many pursuits will not pay off in this life. Relationships, money, jobs, many things will not pay off. But the pursuit of God will always pay off. He always pays back the good things that we seek from him. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and then what? And all these things will be added unto you. God owns it all. Don't pursue the stuff, pursue the Savior. And you'd be amazed how God gives you the stuff as well. The fact that the Magi asked the current violent king about the king of the Jews means they risked their lives to find him. In finding Jesus, the Magi worship him and offer gold for a king. So imagine this. Ready? I'm going to close with this. Joseph and Mary, dirt poor. You think you're poor? You're not poor. You think you got a hard time paying the bills? You don't have a hard time paying the bills compared to Joseph and Mary. They're so poor, friends, they had to give birth in a barn. They didn't even get a house. They didn't have the money to make a way into the house. If you're OCD and you have to wash your hands a lot and you like to be sterile, eat your food sterile, make sure everything's sterile. You don't even need to eat at other people's houses without bringing your own spoon or whatever. Imagine giving birth in a trough, ladies, where you push out your newborn, not in an incubator, not at the sweet Temecula Valley Hospital. You push out your baby in some hay and some dirt and some manure. That's the God of the universe, how he came to poor parents. Watch how amazing this is. All of a sudden, the wise men show up and they just hit the stinking lotto. The wise men come in, rolling deep with all the peeps. And they walk into the house, not the manger. They walk into the... Joseph's like, oh, dude, another salesman. And he opens the door, and all of a sudden, here are the intellectual elite from Babylon. And they walk into the house, and they find Jesus. And it says they open up their gifts. And you know one thing they gave him? Was gold. And for a dirt poor family that just less than a year ago had to give birth in a barn, all of a sudden, boom shaka, they just went from the bottom to the top. They have who knows how much bags of gold that they put down in front of Jesus. Possibly hundreds of thousands, millions of dollars of their currency worth of gold. Gold for a king. That these men were kingmakers. They weren't just the intellectual elite. They actually made kings. When kings were going to be crowned, like if I was the king and my son was going to be the king because I was dying, I wouldn't just crown my son. Actually, the Magi would come and crown my son. Because as I died, I wanted to make sure the best of this kingdom were loyal to the king. So the Magi are actually kingmakers because they control what happens in the kingdom. And when they come to Jesus, it says they don't just give him their stuff, it says they worship him. And they give him gold for a king, and they give him frankincense, which was like a resin. It looks like hard sap. And what they would do is the priest would grind this up and they would throw it on the coals of the altar. And so this would pre-shadow, really, along with its intrinsic value, would pre-shadow Jesus' role as a priest. And it says they also gave him myrrh. And myrrh was an oil that was often used in Jewish burial rites, where they would wrap up the person who died in cloths, and they would sprinkle this oil all over them along with crushing up some of the myrrh so that as the body decomposed, it wouldn't smell. And this is exactly what they did to Jesus after he died on the cross. They give gold for a king. They give frankincense for a priest. And they give myrrh for his death. And it's interesting to me that I wonder if Mary saved some of this because it came in jars. And I wonder if Mary, like many moms, put away stuff from their child's birth or when they're young. And I wonder if Mary held on to a jar until the day Jesus died. And I wonder, as Jesus was going to be prepared for burial, if she was ready to bring what the Magi brought to his birth. 33 years later, she's going to prepare him for death. And I love the fact that the Magi brought their best to Jesus, but they didn't just bring their stuff, they brought their heart. And it says they fell down, these kingmakers fell down in front of Jesus, and it says they worshiped him. And as we close, that's a really important reality. That this next year, don't let 2016 be a year where you give Jesus the minimum, but let it be a year where you give him your all. Not only stuff, but your heart. Not just your intellect, but your heart. Where you live is your heart. What you learn is just in a book. But the Magi gave him their mind, their heart, and their goods. They gave everything they had to the King of Kings.